Good evening. It is my privilege to welcome you to our 25th annual Watch the Hills Christmas program. My name is Deborah, and this is Zach.
We're so glad you have chosen to join us this evening. We would especially like to welcome those joining us live via our internet broadcast somewhere around the world. We would love to hear from you, either through the live chat box on YouTube, or you can email us at info@watchitahillsacademy.org. That is info@watchitahillsacademy.org. So, whether you are here in Amity or thousands of miles away, we hope that you will feel a part of the Watchita Hills family as you watch and worship with us. We pray that you might be blessed as we encounter the Prince of Peace together.
As we begin this evening, please join me as we pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this opportunity to play music for your glory. I want to thank you for all the people who are present here today, and please be with the other people who are still on their way. I want to ask that you would be with the program, that we would glorify you. And tonight, Lord Jesus, I pray that we would invite the Prince of Peace to be among us. Amen. One of the most recognized and thrilling parts of the Christmas story is the appearance of the angels to the humble shepherds on the hills of Bethlehem. Bursting with exuberance, the angelic multitude came to announce the greatest event in human history. The long-prophesied Messiah had finally been born. Never have human ears heard such a song. Never have human eyes seen such a sight. With irrepressible joy, they came to share the greatest news ever given to mankind. The Son of Righteousness had come with healing in his wings. Filling the sky from east to west and echoing from hill to vale, the vast angelic choir peals forth their majestic chorus, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace, goodwill to men."
Thank you.
However, in order for us to truly understand the incredible significance of that glorious song, we have to pause and consider that this song was not sung for the first time. This chorus had ever been sung. For its first rendition, we must go back in time, back to the darkest hour in human history, back to the moment when sin first entered planet Earth. The rebellion which Satan had started in heaven had now spread to planet Earth. Adam and Eve had doubted the love of God and eaten the forbidden fruit. And since the wages of sin was death, mankind was lost. Sadness and horror filled all of heaven. No note of joy, no voice of singing, no anthem of praise rang through the heavenly courts. All was wrapped in silent grief. But no. In the council of heaven, Jesus reveals to the celestial beings that a plan has been devised to redeem lost humanity. However, Christ explains to the heavenly angels that the plan involved all heaven and its infinite sacrifice. In grief and wonder, they listened to his words as he told them how he must descend from heaven's purity and peace, its joy and glory and immortal life, and come in contact with the degradation of earth to endure its sorrow, shame, and death. He was to stand between the sinner and the penalty of sin, yet few would receive him as the Son of God. By his own experience, become acquainted with the sorrows and temptations which man would have to endure. He must be delivered into the hands of wicked men and be subjected to every insult and torture that Satan could inspire them to inflict. He must die the cruelest of deaths, lifted up between the heavens and the earth as a guilty sinner. He must pass long hours of agony, so terrible that the angels could not look upon it, but would veil their faces from the sight. He must endure the anguish of the soul, the hiding of his Father's face, while the guilt of transgression, the weight of the sins of the whole world, should be upon him. It was a plan too painful to comprehend. However, as the blessedness of a world redeemed dawned on the angelic host, as they beheld by faith a great multitude which no man could number, all of nations and kindreds and peoples and tongues, standing before the throne, Scripture records that the morning stars sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy. The glory of and blessedness of a world redeemed outmeasured even the anguish of the Prince of Life. Through the celestial courts echoed the first strain of that song that angels sang above the hills of Bethlehem. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace, goodwill toward men. The anthem was and is the song of a Redeemer, a Savior, and yet the fulfillment of the promise tarried. Century after century went by and no Redeemer appeared. For ages, God's people have pleaded for it to be fulfilled. The heart cry of humanity has been for a Redeemer. Thank you.
The earth was dark through misapprehension of God, that the gloomy shadows might be lightened, that the world might be brought back to God. Satan's deceptive power was to be broken. This could not be done by force. The exercise of force is contrary to the principles of God's government. He desires only the service of love. And love cannot be commanded. It cannot be won by force or authority. Only by love is love awakened. To know God is to love him. His character must be manifested in contrast to the character of Satan. This work only one being in all the universe could do. Only he who knew the height and depth of the love of God could make it known. Upon the world's dark night, the Son of Righteousness must rise with healing in his wings. When the great clock of time reached the appointed hour and the fullness of the time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. And his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace.
Thank you.
The story of Bethlehem is an exhaustless theme. In it is hidden the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God. We marvel at the Savior's sacrifice in exchanging the throne of heaven for a manger, and the companionship of adoring angels for the beasts of the stall. Human pride and self-sufficiency stand rebuked in his presence. Yet this was but the beginning of his wonderful condescension. It would have been an almost infinite humiliation for the Son of God to take man's nature, even when Adam stood in his innocence in Eden. But Jesus accepted humanity when the race had been weakened by 4,000 years of sin. He came with a heredity, as we have, to share our sorrows and temptations, to give us the example of a sinless life and give his life a ransom for many. Sing, O ye heavens, shout for joy, O ye earth, for the Lord hath comforted his people. He hath redeemed Israel.
Thank you.
At this time, we would like to invite all the men in the congregation who would like to sing with a male chorus to join us on the stage. So please join us. We would love to enjoy your lovely voices. We marvel at the Savior's sacrifice in exchanging the throne of heaven for the manger, and the companionship of adoring angels for the beasts of the stall. Human pride and self-sufficiency stand rebuked in his presence. Satan in heaven had hated Christ for his position in the courts of God. He hated him the more when he himself was dethroned. He hated him who pledged himself to redeem a race of sinners. Yet into the world where Satan claimed dominion, God permitted his son to come. A helpless babe, subject to the weakness of humanity, he permitted him to meet life's peril in common with every human soul, to fight the battle as every child of humanity must fight, at the risk of failure and eternal loss. O come, all you faithful, come and behold him.
Joyful and triumphant.
Christmas is for kids. And that seems appropriate since, after all, it is all about a child, an infant child, born in a stable 2,000 years ago. Ever since then, the story of Christ's birth captivates the hearts and fires the imagination of children the world over. The long journey from Nazareth to Bethlehem, the birth in a crude stable, the sheep, cattle, and donkeys, the shining star of angels, the shepherds on the hills of Bethlehem, and the arrival of the wise men, all speak the language of children. Stories. These were the first Christmas stories. Tonight, Uncle Rob has a special story for all the children. So I would like to invite all the children to come forward and have a seat on the stage for Uncle Rob's story time. So children, come on. Don't be shy.
We are so delighted to have you here this evening. And you know what? Christmas is a wonderful time, especially for children. Ever since Jesus came as a baby, it's just been a delightful time that we can remember, especially what God has done for us. Well, I have a story for you tonight. And let me ask you a question. Have you ever gone to your closet and looked inside and thought to yourself, ugh, too much, can you finish that sentence? Too much stuff. Or maybe gone out to your garage and you say, oh boy, too much stuff. I have a story for you tonight about too much stuff. Although this stuff was not stuff. This stuff was a dog. A dog named Stuff. Can you imagine that? That's a funny name. Here, Stuff. Good stuff. Bad stuff. Stuff, stop eating that stuff. That was a funny name. I don't know how Stuff got his name, but Stuff was his name, and that's what we will call him. He came to the Johnson family when he was only a puppy. Now, I have to tell you something about the type of puppy he was. You see, he was a Bernese Mountain Dog. And I don't know if you've ever seen a Bernese Mountain Dog before, but a Bernese Mountain Dog is a big dog. It's black and it has a white mane, and it's kind of like a Saint Bernard. Now, Saint Bernards are big. These Bernese Mountain Dogs can grow to be over 100 pounds, and if they were to stand up on their hind feet, they would be taller than any one of you. In fact, in the Swiss Alps, where these dogs were first bred, they were actually used to be draft animals. Do you know what that means? They would pull little carts and maybe sleds. Can you imagine singing, oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-dog open sleigh? Wouldn't that be funny? They would actually pull sleds. They were big dogs. And when Stuff came to live with the Johnson family, he was only a puppy. Now, what happens to puppies, though? They don't stay puppies, they grow. And you see, that's what happened to Stuff. And what else happens, what else do puppies do? They eat and they get into trouble. Yes, indeed. In fact, we have a puppy at our house and we have some hose in the backyard. A garden hose? Well, we had one hose, but now we have five hoses. Because that dog did a number on those hoses. And these dogs, this puppy Stuff, he started growing. In fact, when Mr. Johnson would go on a business trip and he would come home, why, he would take a look at Stuff, and he had grown by leaps and bounds. And he said, oh, boy, when is this puppy going to stop growing? How are we ever going to feed him? I tell you, he's a lot of trouble, he did. Why, indeed. Although Stuff must have thought that was a compliment, because you see, he would bark and wag his tail, and boom, there would go all the knickknacks off the coffee table that Mrs. Johnson had put there. And Mrs. Johnson would say, oh no, that dog is a lot of trouble. That's right. Well, you see, one time Mrs. Johnson made a whole batch of peanut butter cookies. Do you like peanut butter cookies? Yeah. Yeah, you do? Well, I'm glad you like them. I like oatmeal cookies. You can eat mine. But do you think Stuff might like peanut butter cookies?
Yeah.
Oh, you can bet he did. And Mrs. Johnson put that nice plate of oatmeal cookies, we get them straight here, of peanut butter cookies on the table to cool. And when she came back a little while later, what do you think she found? A near empty plate, because Stuff had eaten every cookie that she could reach. Now, what do you think Mrs. Johnson said? Oh, that dog is so much trouble. Well, Stuff wasn't very obedient. And sometimes when Mr. Johnson would call Stuff, you know what Stuff would do? He would look at Mr. Johnson, wag his tail, and then run the opposite direction. And Mr. Johnson would say, oh, that dog, he's so much trouble indeed. Why, they had a daughter, the Johnsons did, whose name was Dana. And Dana was getting worried because she thought that, well, Stuff was so much trouble that maybe one day Stuff was going to be taken to the pound. Now, she liked Stuff, and she began to get worried. Well, one winter day, as the Johnsons came home from church with a group of friends that they had invited over for lunch, they were sitting around eating their lunch meal, when suddenly one of the boys stood up and pointed out the window and said, hey, what's that? Well, Mr. Johnson and all the family looked out the window, and what do you think that they saw? Stuff. Stuff, indeed. They saw Stuff, and he had gone down the hill to the pond, and the pond was frozen over with a little bit of ice, and that crazy dog had gone out on that ice, and what do you think had happened to him? Crack. Kaboosh. And there was Stuff out in that icy cold water struggling to get out. But you know what he would do? He would put his front paws up on that ice, and then he would try to lunge up there, and he would slip back in. And then with another big lunge he would get, but the ice would go crack and would fall, and he was back in that water. And I'm sure he was getting tired, and I'm sure he thought that he was going to die there in that icy pond. Now, what do you suppose that Mr. Johnson did when he looked out that window and he saw that there was Stuff out in that icy water? What do you suppose he did? Do you think he said, that dog, he is so much trouble. Let him get what he deserves. You think he did that?
No.
Oh, no, he didn't. Why, Mr. Johnson leaped off the couch, and his watch went flying across the room. Then he flew down the stairs, and he left his good shirt at the bottom. Then he rocketed out the door, and he left his suit pants on the front porch. Then he ran down the hill, leaving his shoes flying across the yard. And he got down to that pond, and he broke through the ice and made a path all the way out to Stuff. Then he grabbed that wet, heavy, cold dog, and he picked him up, and he carried him all the way up the hill back into the house. And then do you know what he did? He put him right in front of the fireplace, and he built a fire, and he got a towel, and he started drying Stuff off. And then he kept saying things like, oh, good Stuff. Oh, nice girl, and things like that. Why, he even gave Stuff some of his own lunch. Well, that was amazing. Now, do you know what? That is a good illustration. Mr. Johnson saved Stuff from the ice. But do you know what Stuff did ever after that? Stuff loved Mr. Johnson more than anybody else in the whole world. And wherever Mr. Johnson went, that's where Stuff went also. And when Mr. Johnson called, you know what Stuff did? He came most of the time, or she did. She came most of the time, although she wasn't quite perfect. You know, God looks down at this world, and he sees a people that are trapped by something much worse than an icy pond. He sees them trapped by a pond of sin, and they're about ready to die. And what did God do whenever he saw us? Do you think he said, oh, those people are so much trouble. Let them get what they deserve. Did he say that?
No.
What did he do? You know what he did? He took off his royal crown, and he jumped out of his royal throne, and he laid aside his royal robes, and he ran all the way down to this icy pond called planet Earth, and he died on a cross for you and for me. And you know what? One day he's going to come back, and he's going to lift us up, and he's going to wipe away all our tears, and he's going to take us to a beautiful home, and he's gonna give us his own special food and give us new clothes to wear and a crown on our heads. And don't you think because Jesus has saved us, we ought to love him more than anyone else in the whole world? And whatever he wants us to do, don't you think we should follow it? I think we should. You know, in the Christmas story, there was a story of three wise men that came to Jesus. And they came to find Jesus. And when they did, do you know what they gave him? They gave him gold, myrrh, and frankincense. Were those the best things that they could give Jesus? They were. And we should give Jesus our very best as well. Now, does this look like a lot of fun up here? You've had some fun. I want you all to come to one of my bell choir ringers here, and you can help us ring a story here called The Three Wise Men. All right? If you'll come on over to one of them, we will hopefully be able to make a song here this morning. Come up to one of the bell choir ringers, and they are going to help you to be able to ring. Just get a pair of set of the mallets there. If I can find my stand. All right, just get a pair of mallets. They'll help you out here. Now remember, those wise men, they gave Jesus their very best. They gave him gold, frankincense, and myrrh, and they searched for him with all their heart. And that's exactly what we should do. We should search for Jesus with all of our hearts. Everybody got somebody there? All right, come on up and... go ahead and go to Jesse there. All right. Bearing gifts we traverse afar.
Angels of God sang his praises over the hills and plains of Bethlehem. Glory to God in the highest, they sang, and on earth peace, goodwill to men. Oh, that today the human family could recognize this song. The declaration then made, the note then struck, the tune then started, will swell and extend to the end of time and resound to the ends of the earth. It is glory to God. It is peace on earth, goodwill to men. When the Son of Righteousness shall arise with healing in his wings, the song that started in the hills of Bethlehem will be re-echoed by the voice of a great multitude, as the voice of many waters, saying, Alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth.
Shining in the east beyond them far, and to the earth it gave great light, and so it continued both day and night.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. This gift reveals the Father's heart. It testifies that the thoughts of God toward us are thoughts of peace and not of evil. It declares that while God's hatred of sin is as strong as death, his love for the sinner is stronger than death. God collected all the riches of the universe and gave them all into the hands of Christ, saying, "All these are for man. Use these gifts to convince him that there is no greater love than mine in earth or heaven. His greatest happiness will be found in loving me."
The lyrics to our next song read, "I cannot tell why he whom angels worship should set his love upon the sons of men, or why as shepherd he should seek the wanderers to bring them back, they know not how or when. But this I know, that he was born of Mary, when Bethlehem's manger was his only home, and that he lived in Nazareth and labored, and so the Savior of the world is come. After reviewing his life from his birth to the cross, the final verse takes us all the way down to ultimate completion of the great controversy with these words. I cannot tell how all the lands shall worship, when at his bidding every storm is stilled, or who can say how great the jubilation, when every heart with love and joy is filled. But this I know, the skies will thrill with rapture, and myriad human voices sing. And earth to heaven, and heaven to earth will answer. At last, the Savior of the world is King. As the ensemble plays, consider what you know about Jesus, the Prince of Peace. As Mary looked into the tender face of her baby, we can only wonder at what thoughts must have coursed through her mind. Although an angel had announced his birth, what did she truly understand of his life and mission? What conception did she have of his true identity? He was, after all, a baby in a manger. As we conclude this evening with a song considering who that babe in Bethlehem really was, it is our prayer that you may consider who he really is to you. A Savior of the world who came 2,000 years ago is of no benefit unless he is our Savior who comes to us today. At the birth of Jesus, the angel announced, "Peace on earth and goodwill to men." Jesus is ever ready to speak peace to souls that are burdened with doubts and fears. He waits for us to open the door of the heart to him and say, "Abide with us." He says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me."
Mary, it is you.
Heaven and earth are no wider apart today than when shepherds listen to the angel song. Humanity is still as much the object of heaven's solicitude as when common men of common occupations met angels on the hills of Bethlehem.
And yet, times have not changed. Human history is fast coming to an end. Today, prophecy is being fulfilled, and yet events upon which the attention of all heaven is focused are undiscerned by man.
Men acknowledge Christ in history, while they turn away from the living Christ. Christ in his word, calling to self-sacrifice, in the poor and suffering who plead for relief, in the righteous cause that involves poverty and toil and reproach, is no more readily received today than when he came 2,000 years ago.
The angels that sang glory to God in the highest, on earth, peace, goodwill to men, will one day sing that song again. Once again, they will fill the sky from east to west. Once again, their chorus will echo across the plains. Now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. Friends, our Redeemer is coming again.
A.J. Gordon was the great Baptist preacher of the Clarendon Church in Boston, Massachusetts. One day he met a young boy in front of the sanctuary carrying a rusty cage in which several birds fluttered nervously. Gordon inquired, "Son, where did you get those birds?" The boy replied, "I trapped them out in the field." "What are you going to do with them?" "I'm going to play with them. And then I guess I'll just feed them to an old cat we have at home." When Gordon offered to buy them, the lad exclaimed, "Mister, you don't want them. They're just little old wild birds and can't sing very well." Gordon replied, "I'll give you $2 for the cage and the birds." "Okay, it's a deal, but you're making a bad bargain." The exchange was made, and the boy went away whistling, happy with his shiny coins. Gordon walked around to the back of the church property, opened the door of the small wire coop, and let the struggling creatures soar into the blue. The next Sunday, he took the empty cage into the pulpit and used it to illustrate his sermon about Christ's coming to seek and to save the lost, paying for them with his own precious blood. "That boy told me the birds were not songsters," said Gordon, "but when I released them, they winged their way heavenward. It seemed to me they were singing, 'Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed.' And indeed, this is the message of the season."
"And it's the song that is sung in every carol, 'Redeemed.'"
"It's the meaning behind every gift placed under the tree, 'Redeemed.'"
"It's the word that the shepherds heard, 'Redeemed.'"
"It's the star that the wise men followed, 'Redeemed.'"
"You and I have been trapped by sin, but Christ has redeemed us. Glory to God in the highest,
and on earth, peace, goodwill to men."
Let's bow our heads for prayer. Father in heaven, Lord, I want to thank you for this opportunity, dear Father, to praise your name and to remember that in this season, dear Father, to remember that your baby boy, your son, was given to us. And Lord, I just ask and pray that we contemplate the seriousness of his coming and what was really at stake. Father, I ask and pray for each and every one of my friends here, that they may not just leave thinking that was a great event. No, Father, rather, but they leave thinking, "God, I want to know you more." Father in heaven, I pray you may be with us, and I ask these things in Jesus' almighty, wonderful name. Amen.
Amen.